So if you want to feel old, 2007 was about 18 years ago. I know, it's a whole baby. And so the car industry has changed a lot. And one of the things that I was looking into is why torque became such a big marketing point for automobile makers. And I used to think it was because of cost, but that's only one side of the story. What's up, guys? My name is Chris, and welcome to The Breakdown, where we talk about everything cars, news, and reviews. If you're new to the channel, welcome. If you're not, welcome back. So the point of this video is not to focus on the marketing schematics of car companies, but really the story goes so much deeper than that. 2007 is a really huge year for the automobile industry and fundamentally changes it as we know it today. I will try to not be so technical, but I can't help it, unfortunately. And I think it's a really good deep dive because we as car enthusiasts complain a lot about what we're not getting, and we forget that we're only a small fraction of the people that buy cars each and every day. And that's not to reduce us as a community, but it is to give some perspective on how things have changed. And beyond the manual transmissions, beyond the turbocharged downsized engines, and beyond the electrification of everything, 2007 is where literally everything changes. And in this video, we'll be talking about that. So with that being said, stick around, get your Fergie CDs out, because we're going back to 2007, baby. I know. So with that being said, stick around and stay tuned, because you are now watching The Breakdown. So I want to preface by saying this. The car industry as we know it today is very different. You know, we have a lot more turbocharged engines, a lot more automatics, less manuals, and EVs are creeping up on our asses. And I think it's fair to say that the car community misses performance. We miss the specialness, and we miss the embrace of cars. And it's a very different world. But I want to take you back to 2007 and a little further back than that, probably 2006, because that's where it all starts. So we're going to begin the story here in the United States, which, by the way, the focal point will be both the United States and Europe. And so between 2006 and 2007, everything's honky-dory. We're good. I mean, the economy's booming. You could get a house for virtually nothing, which unfortunately I missed out on that because I was born in the wrong time period, but that's besides the point. But the car industry was very different back then. Back then, when a car company released a car, we got excited. And I think the thing to remember is that this is also pre-internet days. So when a car was released, you only had physical publications. You didn't have online presence. And so the excitement was very different. And this was also the boom of auto shows. Now, auto shows have been a thing since the early 1900s. But during this time, we were seeing a resurgence of automobiles because, you know, many car companies have gotten their footing, they've gotten everything right. And a lot of them are starting to come out of their shell. I think at one point, Honda actually had planned to have a V8, and they were supposed to introduce it. But V8s is a very interesting segue. So back then, pre-2007, you had a lot of big, bulbous, bold, ignorant engines, and they made a billion horsepower. I'm exaggerating. And they had monstrous torque, and horsepower was the name of the game. The more horsepower you had, the more awe-inspiring you were. Well, apparently during the Bush administration, Secretary of Energy Samuel Bodman was the person who was over the Department of Energy. And there was a small push, just an itty-bitty push, for efficiency.
The bill I signed today takes a significant step, because it will require fuel producers to use at least 36 billion gallons of biofuel in 2022. This is nearly a five-fold increase over current levels. It will help us diversify our energy supplies and reduce our dependence on oil.
Now, this was during the time where everything was in place, there was no real issues, and the Bush administration was working its way to separating and divorcing itself from the dependence of oil overseas, which we all know how that turns out. Over in California, you also had Elon Musk, who was basically, this was around right about 2007, which he was basically the spokesperson and the mouthpiece for Tesla. And we have seen that translate in today. And I'm going to leave a really, really good overview of how he became who he is. But before 2007, Tesla was doing okay, and much of the money that had been spent and put into Tesla had come from Elon himself, because he was a huge person invested in the company. So there's this big push from the Secretary of Energy to focus the efforts towards divorcing the United States' dependence on oil. Over in Europe, there also is a lot of talks, there's a lot of studies, and there's a lot of understanding that climate change is a very real thing. So basically, the International Organization of Motor Vehicles understands that climate change is a very real thing. And even though cars don't represent a huge portion of the carbon dioxide emissions, they understand that something needs to be done, because the balance of climate change is very delicate. And we see that today with the fires and the hurricanes and everything else. People, climate change is very real. Please do what you can. So 2007, the Bush administration signs into act the Energy Independence and Securities Act. Now, this act is very, very, very important. Prior to this act, it was not unheard of for car makers to make a lot of different internal combustion engines that produce a lot of horsepower, and there was no regard to efficiency. Sure, we had 4-speed, 5-speed, even 6-speed automatic transmissions, but there was no regard to the engineering of it, and the CAFE has been around since the 70s, but a lot of people have not really thought about it, especially small but delicate increase of popularity in SUVs. Once this act is signed, we are focusing our efforts in a completely different direction. So in this act changes fundamentally everything that you know. Now, there's a lot of talk of why car companies downsize engines and why everything has to be turbocharged instead of naturally aspirated, and why the automatic transmission has overtaken the manual transmission. All of this is tied into this act. What this act says is basically that the United States is going to focus its efforts on separating itself from having so much dependence on the OPEC, I guess, if you will, overseas, and we're going to focus on alternative fuel vehicles. And this promotes a lot of different funding for a lot of different alternative fuel sources. And who is at the head of electrification? You guessed it, Elon Musk and his Tesla brand. Now, there would be a lot of talk around Tesla at this point, because when Tesla first debuted back in 2007 as a roadster before they became the Model S, there was a lot of hype around it, because this has been technology that nobody's ever seen before. And Elon Musk and Eberhard were working together, but Elon eventually overtook the Tesla brand, and the hype when it was initially launched was really big on what the Tesla Roadster could do. And the Energy Independent Securities Act was basically a way for the entry point for a lot more EVs, and EVs, hybrids, plug-ins, all those things were kind of the back burner. But because over in Europe they had been considering it, and they were focusing strategies and efforts to focus their efforts on trying to reduce climate change, a lot of the United States almost fell in line in parallel for different reasons, but they fell in line. And so Elon and Tesla are slowly becoming bankrupt. And as the Bush administration exits, the Obama administration enters. And we all know that that environment was very different. And Obama came in with a lot of different proposals and strategies. And he was kind of looked at as the person to help save the United States, because at the time, the world is in a bit of a recession. Just a little bit. And during this time, Obama is following suit with what Bush had signed. Now, for context, the act that Bush signed in was essentially a format that said they were going to focus their efforts on alternative fuel vehicles, but also that the miles per gallon based on the CAFE would be an average of 35 miles per gallon by 2020. And once Obama comes in, he further, and this is a little bit ahead of myself, but he will capitalize on that, but I'll get into that later in the story. Now, in that act, there is a lot of funding towards electrification and alternative fuel sources, studies, and everything else. There was a study done by the University of Melbourne around a Ford Fiesta and the downsizing and the sustainability of turbocharged engines versus naturally aspirated. Now, there was a lot of backlash when the act was signed during the Bush administration, because a lot of car companies lobbied against it because they felt as though it was impractical for them, especially considering the cost, and it would require them to change a lot of what they were doing in their own trajectory. And I've said this before, that the car companies have on average 4 to 5 years to develop these cars, because they have to be within compliance and regulations. There's a reason why some companies don't report their sales, or they don't report certain elements of their business. For example, a lot of the luxury car companies do not fall within the CAFE standards, so they just pay the fines and move on with their day because they don't want to sacrifice the performance of their cars for their customers. And it's been harder and harder as more pressure intensifies. But during the 2007 Act, that's when we begin to see a lot of shifts from performance to efficiency. And so this would have a very long trickle effect into the way that we see cars today. One of the biggest things that happened out of this is the shift from regular internal combustion engines into hybrids, as well as turbocharged engines. And you don't really see supercharged engines, but turbocharging is the most effective and efficient way to get the most power out of a smaller engine. And a lot of the car companies you see today, like Kia came out with the turbo, Ford has their EcoBoost, of course, the Honda Earth Dreams turbo. We see a lot of those things, and those didn't even happen really until the last 5 or 10 years. But as I said before, a lot of the car companies had to shift over what they were going to do and focus their efforts into the turbocharging and force induction and the hybrid powertrains to meet these efficiency standards. Now, around 2008, 2009, a lot of car companies, including Ford, General Motors, as well as Tesla, all take loans from the government. And one of the biggest loans that came out of that was the Tesla loan. And I believe it was roughly about $475 million that they had to pay back. Now, the other thing to remember is that also, in addition to forced induction, we also begin to see a lot less manuals. And part of that is because automatics are taking off. Now, if you remember in the earlier part of the 2000s, we used to have 4 and 5 speed automatics. And in some cases, you would have 6 speed automatics. And the reason why standards or manual shift, I just aged myself with that, but the standard manual transmission oftentimes came with cheaper cars. And I think that also is a bigger proponent of what we don't talk about in the car community, is that cheaper cars were cheaper in a value presence. And a lot of manufacturers stopped making them because it was harder for them to continue to make more automatic transmissions than it was the manual transmissions. And we begin to see a lot of the big V8s, V6s also slowly disappear in favor of twin turbos and turbocharged fours. Now, the last thing that you've got to remember also is with the automatic transmission, we begin to see the emergence of the CVT, the ECVT, as well as the other forms of transmission like the electric 1-speed and 2-speeds. Now, the Model S is a big deal, but it would not have been possible had this act never been signed. And I don't want that to be lost on you guys as you're thinking about all of this, is that all of this began with the Bush administration. And there was a lot of backlash from automakers. And I don't want you guys to forget that about these car companies, because car companies like General Motors and Ford and definitely Chrysler were definitely screaming up to high hell, because it is a lot of money to produce these things. And for car companies like Toyota, Nissan, and Mazda, what they really need is more so time. But we see a lot of shifting, and a lot of the reason why you see car companies put so much effort and energy into small cars is because they have to meet this pledge roughly around 2025, which we just hit this year. Now, what does this have to do with you as an enthusiast? What this really says is that car companies are trying to find the balance between performance and efficiency. Now that these things have been met, we can probably see some introduction and focus over into electrification. And as far as Tesla goes, the Model S revolutionized the way that we experience our cars today. And I also want to point out that 2007 also is a ripple effect for SUVs. There is a big misunderstanding around SUVs, because SUVs are low-key an exploitation of the CAFE, and I won't get too deep into it, but basically the way that it goes is that SUVs really started as a loophole, and I think I'm going to do a video about this one day, but SUVs really started out as a loophole back in the late 70s to avoid the fines and the emissions of what was going on during the early 1970s. And of course, you know my favorite, the gas crisis of 1973. And that also ties into our dependence on oil too, but that's a whole different spiel. But towards the latter part of the 2000, 2000s, 2010s, SUVs become more and more prevalent. And one of the reasons why is because it costs manufacturers less to produce. And what we're ultimately seeing is the shift from making just anything you want it to being completely restricted in your regulations really fundamentally changes the way that we as car consumers buy cars today and what we drive today. But the year 2007 is so pivotal because the act ultimately changes the complete direction of where car companies were going and where they are. And that's the point of this video, is just how impactful one simple decision can ultimately change the trajectory of the automotive world. And so with that being said, leave me a comment below and let me know if you knew any of this. And if you believe that the car companies are doing the right thing by trying to just climate change, or do you feel like this is not necessarily the best answer? And as a housekeeping rule, just make sure you keep the comments respectful and objective as possible, because it helps to make for a more constructive conversation. But with that being said, until the next video, I will see you guys later.